diagnostic and treatment of lung cancer.
Dear participant of European School of Oncology, I would like to present my report concerning differentiated approach for diagnostic and treatment of lung cancer. It doesn't work, my...
Не работает это, переключалка времена. Вот капуц пришел, ну ничего. А, пришел.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah,
the lung cancer is the main...
Please do sit down.
Most common malignancy and leading cause of cancer-related mortality. It constitutes 1.82 million of estimated new cases worldwide, and also mortality is very high, more than 1.5 million of cases. In morphological last WHO classification of tumors of the lung, it is represented as epithelial tumors, including adenocarcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma, neuroendocrine tumors of the lung, and large cell carcinoma as a separate tumor. And also some kind of different mesenchymal, lymphohistiocytic, and tumors of ectopic origin, and also metastatic tumors. But most common type of lung cancer is non-small cell lung cancer, because it is about 85% of all cases of lung cancer. And nowadays, it is genomically diverse, because in different kind of pathomorphological tumors, we have a different situation with the gene of mutation. And for example, for adenocarcinoma, it is a EGFR, ALK, HER2, KRAS mutation. And for squamous cell carcinoma, it's a different kind. This is a FDGF1, DDR2, and also EGFR, but not in the same percent of cases. And this picture shows that we can, in squamous and adenocarcinoma patient, different kinds of mutation, and because that we have different, must have a different approach for treatment of these tumors. Chris and co-authors investigated more than 500 tumor specimens and showed that mutation was found in 54% of tumor specimens. And most of them was KRAS mutation, EGFR mutation, EML4 ALK mutation in 7% of cases. In different others, it was BRAF, MEK, AKT1, HER2, PIK3, and others. But what I want to show you and point out this feature, that in different continents and in different race, the percentage of the same mutation is different. For example, in Europe, EGFR mutation was found in 9.5% of cases. In US, in adenocarcinoma patient, it was 70% of cases, and it East Asia, it was most of patients. Most of patients with adenocarcinoma have this mutation EGFR in 78.8% of cases. We know this fact, and we know exactly that Asian patient is more responsible for EGFR tyrosine kinase inhibitors because that situation worldwide. Concerning lung cancer with ALK positive rearrangement, we have nowadays very good treatment for this kind of tumors, and it was crizotinib. Because in the old study, this drug showed excellent results with efficacy, objective response in 60% of patients, and in very good data with median progression-free survival, it is very good. But nowadays we have second generation of ALK tyrosine kinase inhibitor. There are seritinib and alectinib, And in the first clinical investigation, both of these drugs showed excellent results, also with very high median of progression-free survival. For example, for alectinib, it is now not reach, but more than 10.3 months, it was follow-up. For it is better maybe for, that we have from crizotinib. It's very promising drug for ALK mutation non-small cell lung cancer. Concerning other kind of patient, I mean for EGFR mutated patient, I have no possibility to change my slide.
Не меняется слайд. Ребята, обратите внимание. Не работает эта штука.
And there were a lot of investigation with a comparison of EGFR tyrosine kinase inhibitors. No, no, doesn't work. Just a moment, because I want to show you that picture. This is studies of EGFR tyrosine kinase inhibitors versus chemotherapy as first line therapy in EGFR positive non-small cell lung cancer. And all of this trial were positive. And all of this trial showed improvement of progression-free survival in comparison with chemotherapeutical arm of treatment. But only the last two investigations, LUX-Lung-3 and LUX-Lung-6, showed also improvement of overall survival in this category of patients. It was excellent results in these two trials, and because that it was the other kind of study was performed. It was LUX-Lung-7, and in this study, afatinib versus gefitinib as first-line treatment in stage 3B4 EGFR-mutated adenocarcinoma of the lung was investigated. And this study showed improvement of results with afatinib. In the afatinib, this is the upper line, it was shown that progression-free survival was much more better, statistically significant with hazard ratio 0.73 and p-value 0.01 in the arm with afatinib treatment, and then thus we just now have results that afatinib is more effective than gefitinib for this EGFR mutated adenocarcinoma patient. And also the same results concerning overall response, objective response, and also for duration of response was performed. And it is very interesting fact that the efficacy of afatinib in the patient with brain metastasis or leptomeningeal disease is excellent. This data is not from this study, but different population of patient. And you can see that 35% of cerebral objective response was received, and 60% responded exclusively in brain, and 66% have a control of disease. And time to failure was 3.6 months. It is very interesting that no different from those without brain metastasis we received in this analysis of efficacy of afatinib in patients with brain metastasis. Thus, we have now new option for treatment patients with brain metastasis in EGFR positive adenocarcinoma of the lung. Also, in the combined analysis from LUX, LUNG 3 and 6, it was also showed that the improvement of progression-free survival is this very serious, very strong, very difficult for treatment category of patients with brain metastasis showed excellent results because median of progression-free survival was much more better than with chemotherapy. Because in this chemotherapeutical arm, patient concerning chemotherapy schedule have a best schedule regimen for chemotherapy, pemetrexed with platinum and paclitaxel with platinum. This is as a comparison with afatinib. And two more questions was analyzed and evaluated. The first one was about continuation after progression of disease. And it was two retrospective analyses and one comparative study, aspiration trial, where erlotinib after progression of disease was prolonged. And it showed improvement of progression-free survival. It was 14.9 months. And in the arm without continuation after progression, it was only 11 months. Here is the results. It was a positive investigation. And here is the scheme of this treatment. This is progression-free, the first progression. This is progression by RECIST criteria. And then continuation of erlotinib in this arm and the fixed progression. This is a median survival for this group, 14 months. And without prolongation of therapy, it was only 11 months. This is the overall survival of this patient, this progression-free survival. And this suggests the visibility of erlotinib treatment beyond progression. Also, others point out that validation in a randomized setting is warranted. And the other question was possibility to continuation of treatment together with chemotherapy. In this, I know we discussed many times, maybe it is very good to continue after progression with TKIs. Combined TKIs with chemotherapy, it should be good. But this analysis, and especially this IMPRESS trial, showed no improvement of progression-free survival, no improvement in response rate. You see the same percent of efficacy, the same median time of progression-free survival, and a little bit better about overall survival. And it was also analysis in some group of this patient, the patient with T790M mutation negative patient, because this patient must have sensitive to prolongation of TKI together with chemotherapy, but in this group of patients, it is a little bit better, but without statistical improvement. And because this approach, NCCN guidelines version 2015, showed that in the first line, drug treatment for EGFR mutation positive lung cancer, there is a first line treatment with TKI EGFR inhibitors, you see? And if we start chemotherapy before discovered mutation, we can prolong it for chemotherapy TKIs and prolonged treatment together with chemotherapy till six cycles, and then continued, for example, erlotinib or afatinib or gefitinib, and till progression. And then, if we have asymptomatic progression, we can continue erlotinib or afatinib. And if we have symptomatic progression, especially with brain metastasis or some systemic multiple lesions, if we have a possibility to have some kind of local treatment performed, it is possible. We have do this. But if is, we have a multiple disease and decrease of condition of quality of life of patient, we change therapy for first line treatment as a chemotherapeutical schedule as it is recommended for non-mutated non-small cell lung cancer. There are well-known mechanisms of resistance to first generation of EGFR TKIs. It is a T790M mutation in most cases, from 50 till 60% of cases. Transformation for small cell cancer, MET amplification, BRAF mutation, PI3K mutation, and some else. And because we know this, the new possibility and new third generation EGFR were development in the this year, and we have nowadays a new possibility with AZD9291 osimertinib with high response with T790M mutation category of patients, 61%, and olmutinib 55% of efficacy, and this drug is approved in Korea, just now only in Korea, because in Korea was performed excellent study with very good results, and rosiletinib 53%, and two other new drugs with very high activity in this population of patients, and because that we in the near future will have a possibility to treat this patient, and this is the data about olmutinib. EMC I-101 study design, and this excellent response because you can look that confirmed objective response was 46%, and disease control was in 91% of cases. It's very good new population of the new drug, independently of very high price of this drug, but it was excellent activity in resistant first-line chemotherapy. And this is also progression, median of progression-free survival. It is 30 weeks at about more than 7 months. It's good results for pre-treatment, very pre-treatment high patient. And the other new possibilities is anti-angiogenic agents for non-small cell lung cancer. And this is a trial for second line, LUM-Lung1, nintedanib plus docetaxel versus placebo plus docetaxel. Docetaxel is a comparative arm because docetaxel is as a drug for second line chemotherapy for non-small cell lung cancer patients, because that this is as a control arm in many different investigation. And here we can look on this trial. You can look that in total population, here is total population, there is no differences in progression free, in overall, median of overall survival, because overall survival was the main goal of this trial. This is no differences. And what about adenocarcinoma histology? Here we have significant differences, and median of overall survival was 12.6 for new treatment scheme, nintedanib plus docetaxel, and 10.3 for control arm. And concerning adenocarcinoma histology in time since start first-line therapy, less than 9 months, it was the better results with very good differences. This is P0.007 and median overall survival 10.11 versus 8 months. And because that, I would like prefer that this is a new kind of second-line treatment, for non-small cell lung cancer, nintedanib plus docetaxel, but only for adenocarcinoma category of patient, not for squamous cell carcinoma, because of that. And the other drug, you maybe know ramucirumab, because the drug, it is a new multi-target inhibitor with anti-angiogenic activity, and it was approved for gastric carcinoma and also for non-small cell lung carcinoma of the lung. In the study named TRIVAL study, ramucirumab plus docetaxel versus placebo plus docetaxel, and showed improvement of survival. Improvement of survival in this trial, and ramucirumab plus docetaxel is approved for the second line chemotherapy non-small cell lung cancer also. And immuno-oncology. This year is some kind of celebration of new approach for treatment all kinds of solid tumors and also maybe in malignancy of hematological malignancy, because immunotherapy is a new kind and very specific and very effective treatment for all practically kind of tumors, and because that especially for non-small cell lung cancer, and it's the first population for investigation for this kind of treatment. Nivolumab, checkpoint inhibitor, anti-PD-1, in the trial CheckMate 057, showed excellent results concerning progression-free survival. Improvement, you can look here, excellent results. And also, after 12 months of follow-up, we have improvement of also progression-free survival and overall survival with excellent prolonged results. And the other drug from this group of immunotherapeutical agents, it was pembrolizumab. And pembrolizumab in lung cancer was investigated in two dose schedule, 2 mg/kg and 10 mg/kg, and as comparison was docetaxel as approved second line chemotherapy for these patients. And what we have? We have improvement for both of these dose schedule, and with very good differences. You see, this is a new possibility for treatment of non-small cell lung cancer. And as we know, for presentation of Елена Артамонова, it was different situation for adenocarcinoma and squamous cell carcinoma concerning expression of PD-L1, because this is the best results at all for PD-L1 score more than 50%, but concerning squamous cell carcinoma, it is independent from this position efficacy. But nivolumab is approved without obligatory examination of PD-L1 expression, without. Concerning squamous cell carcinoma, it is not so excellent development as in adenocarcinoma patient, but here we have, and I must to remember that on the past, when we have trial with bevacizumab as the first anti-angiogenic agents, bevacizumab was approved only for adenocarcinoma, not for squamous cell carcinoma, because of very high toxicity, as the thromboembolic events and other complication. Investigation of bevacizumab was stopped in that moment. But now we have nab-paclitaxel as a conventional chemotherapeutical new agent, as a maintenance therapy, and reinvestigated cetuximab, and we have also erlotinib, afatinib for second-line treatment. And as a driver mutation, there were the most of them, VEGFR1 amplification, 10 mutation and loss of them, DDR2 mutation, PI3K amplification and mutation, BRAF, HER2, EGFR, and P53. Concerning this mutation, there are just now investigated a lot of new agents. Because, for example, lenvatinib, new agents approved for thyroid cancer just now, maybe will be effective for squamous cell because it is have dealing with VGFR. One mutated gene. Concerning EGFR tyrosine kinase, I remember you that gefitinib showed a signal of activity in second line treatment of squamous cell in INTEREST study. Erlotinib showed activity in second and third line in BR21. Published by Shepherd and others in 2005. Erlotinib showed efficacy for maintenance also in squamous cell in Saturn, published in Lancet Oncology in 2010. And nowadays, afatinib has been investigated in a randomized phase 3 study versus erlotinib in second line treatment for small cell, for squamous cell carcinoma. And here we have results that was LUX-LUNG8, afatinib versus erlotinib in squamous cell carcinoma of the lung. This is a randomized study showed improvement of median of progression-free survival with excellent p-value. Thus, we have the improvement of objective response and the duration of objective response. And also, we have improvement of overall survival. And we have improvement in this comparative study, also in quality of life for all this progression-free overall survival and overall response rate and quality of life. We have improvement with afatinib in treatment squamous cell carcinoma. We have new drug for excellent treatment for squamous cell carcinoma of the lung. And I remember you also that it was a study with cetuximab, the study FLEX study, published by Pirker and co-authors in Lancet in 2009. And nowadays we have the different drug, but also EGFR inhibitor, nesitumumab. Monoclonal antibody showed activity in first-line treatment of squamous cell carcinoma in combination with platinum-based doublet, and the doublet include gemcitabine and cisplatinum. This is a trial, and this is results. You have a median overall survival as the main goal, shows improvement of survival in this possibility. And as an antiangiogenic agent, I remember that nintedanib does not improve in squamous cell carcinoma, and ramucirumab is approved together with docetaxel for second-line therapy of squamous cell carcinoma of the lung. And also nivolumab versus docetaxel showed excellent results, and also in overall survival, the same excellent results comparative with docetaxel plus placebo arm, with you can look, hazard ratio 0.59 and p-value 0.00025. Unusual, excellent result. And I want to modify the algorithm for treatment of non-small cell lung cancer, also only to look that we have many new possibilities for treatment different kind of non-small cell lung cancer that include all possibility which I discussed with you just now. And we have also possibility to include our patient in new clinical trials concerning type of mutation. There is now such kind of trial. If we can think about that, that maybe you can use this possibility for your patient also. I would like to point out also for different kind of lung tumors. This is a neuroendocrine tumors, and there are include small cell lung cancer, large cell neuroendocrine cancer, typical carcinoid, and atypical carcinoid. This is also very interesting part of lung cancer, and the treatment depends on the grade of differentiation of these cancers, and include typical carcinoid low grade, atypical intermediate, large cell high grade, and small cell very high grade also. No, some different tumors with neuroendocrine properties, you can think about this possibility, because sometimes it needs differentiation of drug modifying therapies. Carcinoid tumors of the lung constitute between 1% and 6% of all lung tumors, and about 80-90% of tumors develop within a large bronchus. And typical carcinoids represent the most well-differentiated tumors, and atypical more aggressive tumors, and in atypical carcinoid we can see metastasis of disease at the time of progression. And much more malignant tumors are small cell and large cell carcinoma of the bronchus, and survival depends directly from histological classification and from histological of type of tumors. For example, for typical carcinoid is the highest survival, and for small cell lung cancer we have for decades very bad results, unfortunately. This is a classification because we have a different mitosis, different necrosis, different lymph node metastasis at the time of diagnosis, and different distant metastasis. For example, for small cell lung cancer, we have 60-70% of metastasis for the time at diagnosis, and we have a highest mitosis and higher degree of necrosis of these tumors. Here is example. You can look neuroendocrine large cell lung cancer and small cell lung cancer. But immunohistochemical classification is the same. Very high Ki-67, very extensive necrosis, and very high mitosis in this kind of tumors. And small cell lung cancer associated with smoking usually have central localization, disseminated at diagnosis, associated with paraneoplastic syndrome, sensitive to chemotherapy, and extremely aggressive. We can use staging as a limited disease, as tumors confined to one hemithorax, or extensive disease. And practical approach concerned this staging. In extensive disease, we have as a treatment schedule etoposide plus cisplatinum or carboplatinum, and also the second possibility is irinotecan and cisplatinum or carboplatinum, and prophylactic brain irradiation for any effective cases. And in limited disease, we use concurrent or simultaneous chemoradiation therapy and also prophylactic brain irradiation. I want to repeat you that if you have a disseminated disease and if you have stabilization of disease after chemotherapy or partial or complete response, every time for every patient you can use prophylactic brain irradiation, because that can improve overall survival for your patient. As, and as a second line chemotherapy, it can be used schedule CAV-CAF scheme, vincristine, cytoxan, and doxorubicin, or topotecan, or amrubicin. And what I want to say that small cell lung cancer needed of novel approach. And there are, that were performed a lot of studies, a lot of investigation. All possibility were investigated in small cell lung cancer without success. And for many, many years, we have the same median survival, you can look here, very bad. The same 2 year survival, 5 year survival, and maybe new approach with immunotherapy can be change this situation. Because nowadays we have a trial with nivolumab plus something others, with ipilimumab is one trial, and the other with nivolumab and new drug, and it shows for preliminary data very good response. Maybe it was a future, near future. And what we have new option for neuroendocrine tumors of the lung, this is the applicate of TNM staging, the first one for small cell lung cancer. We know that clinical secretory syndrome may occur with bronchial neuroendocrine tumors, and because that we include in the treatment, especially in carcinoid tumors, somatostatin analog, and also everolimus, it is approved for lung carcinoma, and sinutinib sutent was approved for pancreatic and gastrointestinal neuroendocrine tumors, and prolonged investigation for lung neuroendocrine tumors. For other systemic treatment option, there are investigated new analogs of somatostatin receptors. We investigated also the expression of somatostatin receptors in tumor specimen, because somatostatin analogs must have expression type 2 and type 5 somatostatin receptors. And for treatment large cell neuroendocrine tumors, we use the same approach as for small cell lung cancer, but nevertheless, sometimes we consider about pemetrexed for large cell cases, because the investigation with principal investigator Scagliotti, I remember you, have a good results for non-small cell lung cancer, including large cell cancer, not neuroendocrine, but large cell cancer of the lung, pemetrexed plus platinum compounds with very good efficacy. And the future is, I think, maybe on immunotherapy of cancers. And nevertheless, we have a big possibility here is also for improvement of survival with third generation of EGFR tyrosine kinase inhibitor, and we have nothing here from immunotherapy, but what we have in the last investigation with in the part of immuno-oncology with immunotherapeutical drug, we must have a very quickly and very big improvement in near future. I mean, thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Yes. Вопросы есть, Вере Андреевне?